Performance Anxiety. This show features John Agnello. You might not recognize the name, but you sure know the work. He's had a hand in albums by Mark Lanegan, Dinosaur Jr, Cyndi Lauper, Kurt Vile, The Hold Steady, Sonic Youth, Waxahatchee, Drive-By Truckers, and that just scratches the surface. He tells me how his older brother Tony got him into music, the differences between recording, mixing, and mastering engineers, and how to work with an Olympic snowboarder. He's got his own podcast called Gear Club Podcast that's almost as fun to listen to as this one. John's full of stories about working with some incredible artists. Check out his podcast and his credits. Follow him on Instagram. Follow us at Performance ANX and subscribe, rate, review, and share. Hope you enjoy this chat with John Agnello as much as I did.
Hey, everybody. This is John Agnello, producer, engineer. I've been known to work with bands such as Dinosaur Jr, Kurt Vile, The Drive-By Truckers, The Hold Steady, Phosphorescent, Jessica Lee Mayfield, Waxahatchee. Anyway, I just want to welcome you to this episode of Performance Anxiety. I'm the guest, and it's been a pleasure being on the podcast. Is that good?
My wife just walked by. My wife's actually, it's funny because I had to move all my equipment downstairs to do all this. I usually have it up in my room, and my wife's working from home now, so she's on the phone. She works at a call center for a bank, and so she's on the phone all the time, so I had to move everything downstairs. So I just saw her walk downstairs, so that was unusual. Get back to work. You're the only one making an income right now.
Yeah. So, Sharon works. We moved down from New York, New Jersey in August of 2018, and Sharon works from home anyway.
Oh, okay. So
she manages the band Sunvolt. I don't know if you're familiar with
them. Oh, yeah.
That's how I met her in 99.
Oh, cool.
And she also manages Greg Calbee, the mastering engineer.
Okay.
He's like an old school, famous guy. And then she has two other jobs that she runs an office for a non-for-profit education policy group. And she manages a couple of makeup artists for like Nicole Kidman. But those, you know, like Sunvolt, obviously with the climate not really working and the makeup artists aren't working. So she's concentrating on these two main things she does, which is, you know, I mean, she's in the group. She's in her office all day. You know what I mean? And she just does it. You know, she takes her breaks. And, you know, the nice thing about working from home, as you know, is, you know, if you're on a roll and it's 7 o'clock, you just keep working.
Yeah.
You know, you come out of your office at 8 and then think about dinner. You know, you can have to be more productive.
Yeah. It's a lot better if, you know, with my wife, you know, she's got to be on the clock and off the clock and when they tell her to be.
Right.
And, I actually work, I can't work from home. I work for a medical device company
and,
And it's, I'm more in the inspection side of parts, but, so I can't do my job remotely. I've got to be on the floor. So unfortunately for right now, this is, you know, just a.
You're essential. That's essential.
Yeah.
That's the sadness of it.
That's the first time my company has ever considered me essential. So
you are essential. I was two weeks ago, I was doing some mixing down here at a friend of mine's studio. And it's basically part of the building that my buddy Bo Taylor, who was in a couple of bands I worked with, you know, years ago. And it's his like woodworking company, and you know they're deemed essential. And he popped in for like 5 minutes to talk to me while I was mixing. And I said, "Yeah, I hear all you guys next door working, and you know you guys are essential." And he was like, "Yeah, I can't believe it." I was like, "You know, nothing I've ever done has ever been deemed essential."
Yep. Same here. If I go in for a raise and say, "Hey, you know, I'm pretty essential," like. You're not. Okay. Thanks.
Oh, God.
I'm essential enough to get a little slip of paper to keep in my car so I don't get stopped by the cops. But when it comes to money, you're not that essential.
Right. So funny.
Oh, awesome.
I love the Lanegan one, by the way.
Oh, thank you very much.
It really was great. I listened to that like the day it came out.
Oh, awesome.
And I forwarded it on all the social media because I thought it was really good.
Thank you.
And I mean, he's so great. I mean, I have this not really a love-hate relationship with him, because despite everything we went through together, I never really hated him.
Right.
I was in awe of him. Like, he was one of my, not first, because I worked with some really amazing singers in the 80s, but like in the 90s, he was one of my first, like, in awe, like, how does this guy sing like this? This is giving me chicken skin.
Yes.
You know, recording the vocals and my skin on my arms is tingling and I'm like, fuck, 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 fuck. You know, shit like that.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. That's what I felt when the first time I heard him. I was just, I wish I could get a little bit of Lanegan in my voice, because I hate my voice. I think it's awful.
Yeah. Yeah. So, he's funny also, because I seem to remember that at least on one of the solo records, and maybe it was Field Music or whatever record it was, I remember when it was time for him to actually do vocals I think it might have been that one, but I think he ramped up the cigarettes. Like, he started smoking a shitload.
Oh, wow.
To get his voice all raspy. Now, I could be wrong. I seem to remember an instance where he was like, yeah, I gotta start smoking on the smoke. You know, oh, that's fucking a commitment.
That is, man. That's a commitment to your art right there. Jeez.
Yeah.
But it doesn't surprise me. I mean,
yeah.
He was, I honestly was really surprised he agreed to come on, because.
Yeah.
It was, to me, that was the kind of guy I wanted. It was my 100th episode.
And yeah.
I wanted something a little special for that. So
that was a total get, you know, for me. I was like, it's fantastic. And he's great. The interview is great. So it's even more of a get, you know what I mean? What was it, like an hour and 20 minutes or something?
Yeah, it was. This was my dog barking.
But I think it's like, there's really no dead space in the thing at all. I started listening at like 10 o'clock in the morning, and then just basically I carried around with me through the house, did stuff, and then just at 11:20, I was like, that was fantastic. We had a lot of fun in the 90s, me and him, especially on the Whiskey record. I mean, there was all kinds of shenanigans going on. Like, we would go out all the time after work, and, you know, we did a lot of work. We got a lot of work done. We did really great. We finished the record. And, but, you know, we'd be in cabs in Manhattan going downtown to meet people. And, you know, there were the ruckuses at Max Fish, you know, the fight. Like, it was just chaos. But we had a great time. And, you know, the next day, you know, 11 o'clock, we showed up at the studio and we worked on the record. So
that whole story about him taking the reels, the masters down to the creek.
Yeah, that was with Jack and Dino. And that's typical. I mean, yeah, that doesn't shock me.
So how did you get into music in the first place? Were you playing instruments at all? Or did you ever get into being in bands?
No, my oldest brother, Tony, is 10 years older than me. And he was on music for me growing up. And basically growing up in Bensonhurst, Brooklyn, my parents were immigrants. My father was totally an immigrant, like, you know, spoke broken English and worked in longshoremen. My mom was born in the Lower East Side, but my grandmother was an immigrant on her side. And, you know, they were interesting because they raised like hippie sons. We didn't speak Italian. My oldest brother, Tony, looked like he could have been in the Mothers of Invention. You know, he went on to get an electric engineering gig, a degree in CCNY, and then ended up being like a Grammy Award winning design engineer for digital technology at a company called Eventide.
Okay, yeah.
So he was a big inspiration in my life. But I grew up basically listening to music he listened to, like, you know, the Beatles, the Rolling Stones and stuff like that. And then it got me into music in a sense where I became like the next generation of him.
Okay.
Sorry.
No problem.
Oh, it's through the thing. Let me just do this. Sorry.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm doing a podcast. You want to get in? This is Kara.
Hi. What's up?
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Can I FaceTime you? Yeah, okay. Bye. Happy birthday. My friend Kara's birthday. She manages the Nude Party, which are this fantastic young band on New West.
Oh.
And this woman, Liz Cooper, who's a great singer, like just fantastic. So she's real super young. I know her for years, but anyway, so back to my growing up thing. anyway, so honestly, I learned a lot from my brother. And then when I got old enough to be like 16 or 17, I started working at that company, Eventide, like in the summers, made money and was able to buy my own stereo and stuff like that. So, like I remember buying Queen 2 when it came out as a kid, went downstairs, got a little high, and then basically put on headphones and listened to like the Black Side, you know, which starts with the backwards drums and all that shit. And then it turns around like it. And I looked at the credits and I was like, Roy Thomas Baker. Okay. And then I just became like a Queen fan. Well, I was already a Queen fan, but then I became a Roy Thomas Baker fan. And then when the first Cars record came out, or, you know, he did a record. God, I forget what band he did a record with, a Southern rock band, but twisted it so much that it was almost like insane. And they were like kind of your standard boogie band.
Okay.
I got to remember the name of the record, but I love, that was the only record of theirs I loved. And because it was so twisted because of his production.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So anyway, that's how I kind of got started loving music. And then ultimately my second year of college, I was kind of not really feeling it. And then I was lucky enough to get a interview at the Record Plant in New York as like a cleanup guy, tape librarian. Oh, and they, yeah, they hired me at like 19. So it was 1980. No, maybe they hired me at 20. It was 1979 that I started there.
You weren't, so you weren't playing in bands. Did you learn how to play any instruments at all?
I'm not a musician. So, but what I am is, I'll give you a perfect example. On Resurrection Song, on the Mark record, I'm doing answer vocals to some of his like long notes.
Day, end of day, each hand spirals. What do you make?
Because he didn't want to do it. And I said, Mark, why don't you do like an echo of it? And he's like, I don't want to do it. And I was like, fuck it, I'll do it. But like every now and then I'll sing on a record because the singer doesn't really want to do the harmony, you know? Or I've also on certain records played percussion, and certain records like figured out keyboard melodies to do. I mean, I can figure this stuff out. I'm not a musician.
Wow.
But I've been in the studio. I've been making records for so long that of course I can go up to a piano and figure out a melody. And I've learned through a lot of people how to, watching people, like for example, watching Red Cross in 1994 on the Phase Shifter record, watching how they wrote harmonies blew my mind. And I came from LA on that record. And then when I was driving around in my car, whenever the song would come on the radio, I would sing a harmony or try to sing a harmony to it.
Okay. You know what I mean? Yeah. Yeah.
So stuff like that has constantly been happening through the 30 plus years.
So I heard a little story, and I didn't hear the entire story. So I was kind of hoping you might be able to tell me a little bit about it. Cause I'm not exactly sure what time period this happened, but I read that you got thrown out of your first session.
Yeah.
Okay. So tell me a little bit about what happened in that situation.
Well, you know, I'm a tape librarian. I'm 21. I don't have a lot of experience in the studio at all. And the first time I'm really asked to work on a session, you know, get the kid in there. It's the owner of Record Plant, Roy Sakala. And it's in a room on the top floor. It's kind of like his mix room. It's called the mix room. And it's very private. It's got its own lounge. It's got its own thing. All the way in the back of the room, it's got it's the only room. It's got a dome that leads up to the ceiling, the roof, so you could see light. Okay. It's also a cord room. It's the only studio in the building that had windows, so you could see like Manhattan.
Wow.
But anyway, so he was mixing something, and there was a bunch of stuff set up, and I got in there early, and basically, I, being the neat freak I was, and not realizing that he was preset, I kind of started unpatching things, and I kind of took down his whole setup.
Oh.
And when he walked in, he pitched a fit. And then when we were trying to patch things back in, I just wasn't used to it. Had I not touched anything, we would just would have started and I would have kind of been okay-ish. But because I couldn't really patch well or fast, and he was just like, he was already like, you know, all over my shit. I remember saying that he just called the manager and he was like, call Steve Mark Antonio, who's still like a dear friend of mine. He was the assistant. Like he was two assistants. He was pretty much at that point above me by like three notches of the ladder. He was an assistant engineer, but he had trained me to be a tape librarian like a year ago. You know, get Steve Mark Antonio in. This kid's an idiot. Get him out of here. And I just stood there like almost like crying. And I went back to the tape library. I sat there totally like, I'm going to get fired. I really fucked this up. I can't believe it. And then this the man who ran the remote truck, Dave Hewitt, he came in and he was like, what's the matter, John? And I was like, Dave, I fucked up with Roy. He threw me out of the room. I'm going to get fired. I can't believe it. And he's like, John, you're going to be okay. He's like, you're going to be just fine. I was like, okay, thanks, Dave. And he walked out of the room. And that was it. I never got fired. And, you know, I ended up assisting for Roy a bunch. And he always, you know, the thing was, I think, rest in peace, Roy. He was a really great guy. I think with him, the kids he liked, he really was hard on. You know what I mean? He really was tough. And I think ultimately he did like me because, you know, I did assist for him a lot moving forward when I was an actual proper assistant. I was in over my head at that point.
Right.
You know, and, you know, I got called on it and I learned, you know, the great thing about like the situation with the record plant and being there for 9 years, I guess, was that, you know, when you fucked up, you really learned and you rarely, you know, you didn't fuck up that. You didn't repeat a fuck up, basically. Right. You know, you did it once. You got beat on really hard mentally, you know, like, and then you just sucked it up and you just moved forward. So it was a really great, I mean, I wish everybody could experience what I did and what my buddy Steve did. And, you know, just to put it in perspective, this is 1982 or whatever. This is back when even my parents didn't really know what the fuck I was doing. They knew I went to a place 12, you know, 14 hours a day and I came home, but they had no idea. Like, what do you do? What are you doing? Well, I'm working on music. How do you do that? You know, like the recording studio thing was just a concept. They didn't understand. Right. Like they just, you know, and also when you talk to people, like when I talked to friends, my friends knew I was working in a recording studio, but no one ever listened to music and thought about, you know, how it was made. They just listened to music.
Right. Yeah.
So it was such a weird job to have. It's pretty much the opposite of what it's like now where everybody's an engineer. And, you know, obviously there's no mystique anymore. It's just right there.
Well, one of the things that I've always wondered about, because you see all these credits and you see all these different people with all these credits. I mean, what exactly is the difference between the engineer, the producer, mixer, and the master? How do they differ in their responsibilities?
Well, the interesting thing is, so engineer can either be a recording engineer, mixing engineer, or mastering engineer.
Okay.
So an engineer is touching knobs.
Right.
Somewhere along the line.
Okay.
Recording engineer is setting up mics, you know, kind of in charge. But he's an engineer, but he's actually the recording engineer.
Okay.
And the producer is kind of like the overseer of what's going on between the technical and the artist. Like on records where I'm the producer, because I come from an engineering background, I can easily wear both hats and kind of just navigate through and deal with the artist, deal with the technology stuff. But there are specific producers who don't touch consoles. You know what I mean? Who sit there and deal with the, you know, making of the record, the music, the stuff like that. And they rely strongly on engineers. So, but so when you say what's the difference between an engineer, a mixer and a mastering, well, they're all engineers. So really the three are the recording, the mixing and the mastering.
Okay. Okay. So the recording engineer is, like you're saying, setting up the mics and all. So, and now this is the question I have. I guess this is the one that confuses me the most. What is the difference between mixing and mastering?
Okay, so mixing to me is like it's like being a chef or something. You have all these ingredients, you know. Mm-hmm. Instead of I don't know, instead of beef or vegetables, you have bass drums and snare drums and guitars and bass. But the idea is to take all those ingredients, put it in together, mix it up, and then have it either taste good or sound good.
Okay.
Okay. And then mixing engineers, or at least for me, what I do when I mix is I try to create a foreground background space, left, right. And I just try to have it be like a, you know, like a painting, like depth and stuff like that.
Okay.
And you know, you decide what are focal points in certain parts, like when the singing's, when the singer takes a second for the second intro of the song, well, I'm going to bring up the guitar, or I'm going to bring up this cool bass line that the guy does. That's really cool. So you do stuff like that. I mean, obviously you try to make things sound, you know, the top end is clear, the bottom end is clear. You try to give it impact without too much compression, I guess. The thing is now a lot of people just crush the record so they sound really loud, but there's a balance of, you know, having it sound loud but musical.
Right. Okay.
And I come from an analog space, obviously, like tape. So my feeling is I'd like it to be loud, but I want it to be musical. I want it to sound like music. I don't want, you know, I don't want you to get like a headache three songs into the record.
Right. You
know? But you'd be surprised that does still come around. It's a crazy thing. And then the mastering engineer, I worked with Greg Calbee for years, like, you know, 20 plus years. And he's really, honestly, from like John Lennon rock and roll through Damn the Torpedoes to now like Tame Impala and War on Drugs. This guy's like just still mastering great records. And all I can say about mastering engineers is the way the record usually works with me is when we're tracking the record, doing the recording, I'm doing rough mixes, they sound really good because I'm already doing this stuff to make it sound like a record.
Okay.
And then when we mix the record, I'm taking what I have and I make it sound really good because now I polish it off and I, you know, use the right reverb for the vocal or whatever. I just make it more fun. I, you know, effects come from places. And then when I hand it to Greg, it just ends up sounding like 25% better.
Okay. You
know, and I've actually gone, like, we just finished a record in, well, he just mastered a record for me in March. Artist on Blue Elan Records, an LA label, and the artist is Roan Yellowthorn, and she's fantastic. Like, it's just such a great record.
Oh, cool.
Like, everything about it, the arrangements, her voice, the songs, how we approached it, everything was wonderful.
I liked you best with hair worn long, dancing on the street, swiveling your hips along to a four on the floor beat, tresses combed against your head to show a widow's peak. I heard you sing long before I ever heard you speak. I heard you sing long before I ever heard you speak.
So they had been asking me about mastering too, and I said, okay, Greg's gonna master on March 16th or whatever it was. When we get the mastering, let's hang out on the phone together and let's listen to the mastering and then listen to a song and then listen to the mix, my mix. And we A-beat them. And, you know, the mastering just sounds that much better.
Wow. Okay.
So I can't say he adds a lot of top end or he compresses or he does this, he does that. He does whatever he does, the way he transfers it, he does give it level. But also he gives it a little bit of either compression or EQ, just a little, just enough. But he's got a really great sense of doing the littlest, but making it sound the most.
Okay.
You know?
Okay.
I mean, there is some interesting things. Like he has like cables that sound different, you know, like $5,000 cables. Like, should I use the purple cable or the gold cable? And I've been there and we've A-beat them and they sound different. I mean, it's not who.
Wow.
Yeah, it's real. It's science. It's not. You know, it's not mystical, it's science. But every record with him, I'm very lucky with him. Every record, like I say 25%, it could be 30%, it could be 30%, but it always sounds that much better.
That's okay. Okay. So that kind of clears it up a little bit for me, not being a musician or an engineer myself. So
yeah. Well, people always ask me, why do we need to master this? And right. I'm like, we have to do it. But also, mastering engineers really became a thing back when you were cutting vinyl. Uh-huh. Because back in the vinyl days, if, you know, there's this thing about phase, you know, if something's out of phase with each other, like, you know, if your speakers are out of phase, you have two wires.
Yes.
And they're out of phase, then everything in the middle goes left and right, and there's no low end.
Right. You've had that? Yes.
Okay. Well, if you have phase issues on your record and vinyl, the grooves narrow and the needle pops up.
Oh. So
back in the 70s, 60s and 70s, mastering engineers were actually crucial to the actual just getting the record on vinyl.
Okay.
You know, see the pictures with the guys with the microscopes, they're looking at the grooves, and it's like serious shit back then. I mean, now I still think it's serious shit, but I'm saying it's a different type of thing. But I think honestly, a good mastering engineer, you know, the thing is, a good mastering engineer makes your record sound that much better. You know, I've had like guys fuck around with my records and just like, I've had to call them and say, why'd you roll off the bottom? And they were like, well, the bass drum's a little boomy. I'm like, it's a double-headed bass drum. It's supposed to be boomy. Undo that. You know, like stuff like that. Like, why would you do that?
Right. So they can make it sound, you know.
Well, they can fuck it up. Yeah, no, it's a big responsibility. It really is. You know, like these guys, you know, and luckily on that specific record, I had the guy undo what he was doing. But like I said to him, dude, you don't fix my record. You know, you don't have to fix my record. What I give you is what I want. You know what I mean? And yeah. Even if you think it's wrong, that's kind of what we're going for.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. All right. So I was looking at some of the credits that you've got, and one manner or another, you've worked on some incredible albums. I mean, I was looking, you've worked with, on albums by Aerosmith, Twisted Sister, John Cougar Mellencamp, Cyndi Lauper, yeah. Bruce Springsteen. That's sure. Now. I heard a cool story about Cyndi Lauper, but go ahead. If you're gonna throw a story at me, let me just tell me to shut up.
No, I can give you a story, but I want to be specific about the arc of the career. Those records are all I assisted on them. Because as I became the head assistant at the record plant, now this is going maybe 82 or 83, mm-hmm. when I was the top assistant, it was all, like I said before, the ladder, you know, you got up the ladder. Certain people got jumped off the ladder because they couldn't deal with it. But people, you know, so at a certain point, like my buddy Steve from the other story, he became an engineer. So I just moved up a little more. And at a certain point, I was the top assistant, so I got all the primo gigs.
Okay.
So that's how I got the Michael Schenkers, the Aerosmiths, the John Waite, the John Cougar, the Bruce one. Anyway, and the Cyndi Lauper one. And honestly, it's just a matter of, you know, A, being in the right place at the right time, but also B, like being good enough that like people relied on me. Like I'm still friends with the engineers I worked on a lot of those records, like to this day. Like, and I've been on the, like with the quarantining and stuff, like a lot of us have been reaching out. So I've been I was on the phone with Rod O'Brien, who was good, really still like best friends. And he engineered a lot of the, Aerosmith stuff. But then also Bill Whitman, who engineered a lot of the Cyndi Lauper records, and I ended up being his engineer when he started producing more.
Oh, okay.
I was just with him the other night. So, but you know what I mean? It was such a community, you know what I mean? That you just, once you got to that spot, you got all the really good gigs, and I was psyched. But like on online, you'll see, I do get some Cyndi Lauper engineering credits for that record. I mean, I was on the bubble at that point. I don't think I was necessarily an engineer. Maybe I took over a little bit and did some stuff while Bill wasn't there.
Okay.
But I would say I was, you know, he engineered the record for sure.
Right. Now I heard a story about you were in the room when they started writing Time After Time.
Yeah, how are you hearing this shit?
You know, word gets around. I do my research. I try to do my research.
Yeah. So that's a really good one because I want to tell it right. So I think there's two parts of this story that were equally ridiculously, amazingly real. But the first part is that I think that day we had Sly and Robbie from the Wailers come in and track on a version of Girls Just Want to Have Fun. A ska. Yeah.
Wow.
A reggae version, not a ska version.
Right.
And I think we tracked them all day. And I remember in the morning, Robbie walking in with just a bass, no case. And someone said to him, "Robbie, where's the case for your bass guitar?" And he just said something like, "The plane, man, the plane." And we were like, the plane. Okay. Anyway,
Hervé Villechaize showed up.
It was very strange. But anyway, so we tracked a bunch during the day. And Rob Hyman and Eric Bazillion from the Hooters track with them on keyboards and guitar, respectively. And I guess at one point we were done tracking. And everybody was like, "Let's take a break." And Rick Chertoff, the producer, was like, "Okay, let's go get some dinner." So, and then I was like, "Well, I have to stay and break down the drums and the bass setup because now we're going back to doing vocals and overdubs."
Okay.
And Cyndi had a idea for a song. And Rob Hyman was like, "Yeah, I'll stick around and, you know, I'll work on it." We had the piano. And I was just coiling cables, you know, like breaking down mic stands. And they're just, you know, hammering out some shit.
Yeah.
And Cyndi is like, "I've got this idea for this chorus." And she starts singing, you know, "Time after time, time after time." And then I'm coiling cables. And then I hear, like, I think Rob was like, "Well, how about if we do, like, we add a different part?" And he's like, "If you come, I will walk, I will be waiting." You know, and you can tell if you listen to that song that that's kind of that melody. Well, I know Rob, so I know that I can tell it's his melody.
Right.
You know what I mean? That's a melody he would sing. But when she's on top of it, it sounds fucking great.
Yeah.
But anyway, so I'm coiling cables and I'm not really just watching. I'm doing my shit because when people get back from dinner, I've got to get all set up for the next, you know, the evening.
Right. Thing. Yeah.
But yeah. But sure enough, throughout the course of, I don't know, like an hour, 15 minutes, they pretty much wrote, I think I would want to say like 60% of the song or,
wow,
you know.
They even
came up with, you know, the pre-chord, like, "You say go." So they came up with all that. They were just knocking around.
Wow.
But, you know, but there was, you know, listen, super creative people. I mean, I remember in the control room at one point they were working on She Bop, and I think Rick, the producer, came up with the idea of having it be like, "I bop, you bop, but we," you know what I mean? Like the different alliterations, yeah, or whatever that. And I thought, well, that's a fantastic idea. That changes the chorus like 100%, you know?
It's, yeah.
So my point is, so when you're in a room with super creative people, I mean, you're going to witness some really great shit, you know? And I was a kid, I was like 23. I was like, holy fuck.
Man. And that-
and the irony is, working on that record, I mean, I had no idea that would be an iconic record.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Like, I thought it was really great, but then it came out and then it changed the face of music for a few years.
Yeah. I mean, it exploded. I mean, you couldn't get away from it. It's just, and to think that they were just coming at that, they're already recording and she didn't have that song at all when the session started. That's amazing to me. I love that kind of stuff.
Dude, it's crazy. It was, like I said, I didn't, at the time, I just was doing my thing. And it wasn't until that song, I mean, and I've heard so many covers of it since that record came out. I mean, I think it's like 35 years now, the anniversary. She was like 84.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, no, it's crazy. And I talk to her occasionally. She's fantastic. She's so her.
I see I see her on a lot of commercials right now for skin conditions, but that's about it.
Yeah. Of course. No, but she, you know, she's doing like a lot of Broadway stuff, I guess. And
yeah,
you know,
yeah, yeah.
Quite a bit. In fact, Bill told me this crazy story about they bailed on a benefit in Manhattan in the middle of March, and because they weren't feeling comfortable about the pandemic deal, and they were very lucky because we think that's a bunch of people got sick at that benefit, so they were really fortunate to bail. I don't know the details about when it was, where it was, but I know that he had mentioned that they were really glad that they thought they did the right thing because it was just too scary to do at that point.
You know, I was talking, actually, I had a Mickey Bereny and Moose McKillop on for a little thing I'm putting together, and they were talking about how they think that a lot of it's been spread in Great Britain from this soccer match that a lot of people were at, and it just you get 40,000-50,000 people in the stadium, and
this is why, you know, so we're in Raleigh, and I mean, I'm not going to get super political, but the guys out there, like yesterday in our city hall or whatever, the governor's, the guys downtown, basically, who are all protesting. I mean, they're kind of asking for trouble. I mean, a lot of them aren't wearing masks. It takes one person to cough. It's in the air. I mean, it does spread. I mean, that's why it's a pandemic. So yeah. I think you really gotta, if you don't respect science and the bigness of it all, I think you're asking for trouble, you know?
Yeah, because you may not contract it, but you can be a carrier. So, you got to think about everybody else, too.
And then you can give it to me.
Exactly. We don't want that.
Former junkie, chain smoking, heroin abusing, no, just kidding.
I think at this point you might be immune to it.
Yeah, Richards. Yeah, that's right. There was that meme around going around that it's not as funny now that everybody's dead. Yeah. But there was the meme about I'm immune because I used the CBGB's bathroom.
Yeah.
But now it's that it was funny like a month and a half ago. Now it's not so funny.
I wanted to ask you a couple questions about the 90s because we moved on and you know I just had Mark Lanegan on and he's one that mentioned I should talk with you and.
Oh, great.
So I definitely wanted to find out a little bit more about you becoming more of I guess were you more of an engineer with Dino Jr. and Screaming Trees, or did you produce?
Screaming Trees, let's put it this way. With both bands, I was an engineer with benefits.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like on the Screaming Trees, Don Fleming produced the records. Producer. Did I help out a little extra? Yeah. You know, but who was the producer? Don Fleming. Right. Absolutely. And the same thing with Dino. I mean, with Dino, I feel like I did help out a little extra. And then we all got along. But I mean, you know, Jay obviously was producing the records. I mean, you know. We always joke around. I guess the joke was with Thurston, but then I could transform it to Jay too. It was like, yeah, I ever said, hey, you know, this song could use a bridge. He just punched me right in the nose. Yeah. I mean, like, there's no way to tell Jay Maskus anything about songwriting or production or anything like that.
Right.
You know? But anyway, but the point is, yeah. So if my credits are accurate on those records, it's engineer,
right?
Which is fantastic. But once again, I do think the reason why eventually I started getting production credits is because a lot of the record company and managing type people realized I was doing a little more than just twisting knobs,
right?
But the weird thing about that, and we can go back to the 90s if you want, but I want to just say this interesting story is once I started getting like production gigs, it took me about one or two records to learn that I really had to be more of a producer.
Okay.
You know what I mean? I had to really kind of step it up. You know what I mean? At the end of the day, I was like, I don't really necessarily think I produce this record the way I should. You know what I mean? I needed to do more. Okay. And I kind of had to learn to do more. Right. Yeah, the whole career is basically learning to do more and be better at whatever. You know what I mean? It's like,
now some of the work you did with Dino Jr. is incredible. And one of my favorite tracks, and I know you had a part in this, is the song they did on the Judgment Night soundtrack, Missing Link with Del the Funky Homo Sapien.
overrated. Did you like how I spiked the ball? Despite you all, you can come bite a small portion. There's more in the vault. Parts have a ball. They alter your brain patterns. Yeah, it's my fault. I just stayed at a blitz. A bird's hurt, slip, he damn beat the speech. But you need to reach. I'll just be no simile. Never flow simply. Cause now you be the truth. True, and nothing but the truth. I tell it to the youth, the fellow of the proof in the brain. Wouldn't you like to know? Oh, no, you can't. My flow's never quitting. And I'm the truth, the motherfucking truth, my man, my man.
That whole album is incredible to me. The way they combine rock and rap like that.
Fantastic.
How was that session? That had to be amazing to watch those guys work together.
It was pretty amazing. we did it. I think we did it. We did it in LA at this place in the Valley called NRG, which was a fantastic studio. Watching Jay and Del kind of, you know, deal with each other and work together was fantastic. You know, Jay laid down the drums first and then some of the tracks, and then Del came in and did his thing. But the funny story about that specific track was that Del at one point wanted to do a mix himself to show us what he thought it should sound like.
Okay.
And Del was hitting the weed pretty hard. I mean, it was like 24/7. It was so funny. And believe me, I'm no Luddite. I mean, I'm not like, you know, but I don't at work. I can't do anything like that at work because I'm, you know, the knobs get weird and things sound funny. And so we're back and he's doing this mix and he's like, check this out. And he hits play and it's like vocal and snare drum. There's like no guitars. And we're all, me and Jay and Mike Johnson are looking at each other like, we got problems. We got a problem here. Houston, we have a problem. So we had to get around that. And we did. We ended up getting it. You know, I ended up kind of taking back the mix. And I think we kind of basically just waited until, you know, he kind of fell asleep in the control room. And then we mixed it really fast and got the hell out of there. You know what I mean? And that's what the song ended up being.
Oh, you know? That song is incredible. It's my favorite track off that album.
I still listen to that record.
I do too.
Did you ever see the movie?
Yes. The Jeremy Piven. I liked it. I was a huge Dennis Leary fan back in those days, so I had to watch it. So yeah, I liked it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And of course that was like college years for me. So, you know, I was big into Screaming Trees and Dinosaur Jr. and Pearl Jam, Sonic Youth, all the bands on the album. And it was just and I had never heard anything like that before with the combining of the rock and the rap.
Yeah. Well, the collabs also, whoever figured out the collaborations deserves like a ton of credit because they really, you know, they put real, like, the Teenage Fan Club one is great. I think it was the Teenage Fan Club and De La Soul. I forget which.
Yep.
So good.
Onyx and Biohazard, Faith No More and Booyah Tribe. That was that's Another Body Murdered. That's a great song.
Yeah. Yeah. No, it was a fun record to be a part of, and it was a fun experience. We've had some, that was a wacky experience, obviously.
Now, so Jay didn't really have any input into who he worked with for that?
What do you mean?
So he didn't get to choose who the rapper would be that they were pairing him with?
I have no idea how that went down. They just hired me to engineer, and I did. I don't know the details. If I said anything, I'd be remiss because I don't.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't. How that went down.
Okay. So, and you also did another soundtrack song that I absolutely love, Screaming Trees version of Darkness, Darkness.
Yeah.
Was it the Youngbloods that did that first?
I have to Google it.
I think so. But either way, it's my favorite track off that soundtrack. That soundtrack didn't have a whole lot on it besides the score, but that and right. Living Color.
Yeah.
That was just an awesome.
Yeah, we mixed that one after the fact, and those guys weren't even around. I think it was just me and the manager and the record company guy.
Oh, my gosh.
You know? Yeah, it was so awkward. But, you know, at the end of the day, it was fine. But, yeah, no, it was interesting. And I think maybe the only reason, maybe Mark insisted I do it only because, like, at that point we had this thing where I really was getting a vocal sound for him that he really loved. And like, I would get phone calls from him. What kind of mic do you use on my vocals? You know, U87. Okay. You know, tube compressor. Okay. Yeah. But I think that was part of the reason why they didn't go to like a big shot guy, you know what I mean? Or just another guy or right. girl. Back then it wasn't really girls, whatever. I don't want to go into that. Right. That's a tangent. You don't need to go into it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Now yeah. You mentioned that, you know, Mark's one of the few guys that really can give you the goosebumps when you sing, when he sings, not you. I mean, maybe you get goosebumps when you sing too, but if I'm reading this right, you did do one-off sessions with Bob Dylan and Mick Jagger.
So yes. So Mick Jagger, I assisted on an extra version of the song Hard Woman from his first solo record. And what they did was they did a special video for it. It was like an animated video for MTV. Okay. So we went in and re-recorded the whole version.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And I think that was, I believe it was produced by Rick Chertoff, the Cyndi Lauper producer, and Bill Whitman, my mentor, engineered, and I was the assistant. But my favorite part, well, one of my best memories of that session was while we were doing the basic tracks. So the basic tracks are basic tracks. It's your band mm-hmm. and drums and bass and guitars and whatever the foundation of the track is going to be.
Okay.
So we're doing the basic tracks, and then Mick was out there. Singing. And at one point, Bill, the engineer, soloed the live vocal mic, and Mick wasn't singing, and you hear drums and, you know, all this like ambience in there. And then the second verse comes and Mick stands up to the mic and he starts singing, and you don't hear any leakage. It's like all his voice. His voice was so powerful.
Wow.
That once he started singing, there was nothing else in the mic. It was, and well, he wasn't like distorting the mic or anything, that he was that close or anything. Like, he is just, the way he projected was unbelievable. I still to this day is like, you know, he's an iconic singer anyway. It's not, you know,
yeah.
But the fact is, like, just hearing how great a singer and how great his technique was fantastic. So anyway, that was a great memory. And then just him sitting on the console with his arms around his waist, with his legs crossed, listening to the track and going like, oh yeah. Like Mick Jagger would do.
Doing that rooster.
He walked out of the room and we all just were like, holy shit, I can't believe that fucking Mick Jagger. So great.
And that's one of the cool things that most of the people who listen to don't ever get to hear. Even if you go see him live, you know, you can kind of get how great of a singer is. But if you're in that just small space with him.
Yeah. I mean, everybody knows he's a great singer. But we heard the technicality of it, like
exactly.
the evidence, like the, you know, just his technique is so crazy. And there's a bunch of stories about, for example, John Lennon, who was a great singer, obviously. But there's a story that I've heard a couple of times. I can't corroborate it as being true, but I've heard it from reliable sources where John would cross his mouth with his hand when he popped peas. So he wouldn't pop the peas into the mic.
Oh, wow.
So he would just, you can't see me, but I'm moving my hand across my mouth from one side to the other. And I've heard that he used to do that with peas and sometimes with S's to cut down the sibilance.
Wow.
And I mean, if that's true, which I think, like I said, reliable source, I mean, that's amazing that these guys have this kind of, they're able to sing great, but also their technique is just so fantastic.
That I'd never heard that. That's amazing.
Yeah. Well, back in the analog days, by the way, you know, now with Pro Tools, I could just, if there's a P that pop, I just go in there, I roll off the bottom, and that we're fine. Yeah. You know, on tape, you can't do that. You know what I mean? It's there. You can get rid of it somehow, but it's a lot more fucking work.
Yeah.
So that's why a guy like John Lennon is totally right in doing that, you know?
That's...
So anyway, so the Bob Dylan story is very simple. When he got the Lifetime Achievement Award for the Grammys, I think it was in 88, but I'm not sure. Maybe 90. I think it was 88. They decided to use a track, Series of Dreams, which is a fantastic song, which, you know, I was just amazed that they didn't put that on the record. It's so great.
Yeah.
But we did a remix. So on that one, I think I co-mixed with Bill. And it was the same team. Rick Chertoff produced it. Bill mixed it. I mixed it with Bill. In fact, I did some remixing without all of them because they were all like a week later on a different session. And Bob wanted to use a different first verse lyric. So I had to go in there myself and work on it. But Dylan wasn't there, which in a way, I mean, Dylan is one of those guys that always scares the shit out of me. Like, I think I look up to him so much that I don't know if I could get into a room with him and not piss my pants. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He'd be like, "Hey, John." And I'd be like, all of a sudden I'm all, you know, just because I'm so fucking scared.
Yeah.
So, I mean, whatever. Like, there are songs of his that just make up my part of my DNA.
Oh,
it's like, yeah. So
you've done a lot of work with new bands and some DIY bands, you know, bands like Drive-By Truckers. You know, they started off doing their own stuff. Southern Rock Opera, one of my favorite albums of all time, did it themselves. When you get a new band or a big DIY band in the studio, is it hard for them to take production cues? When you have to, let's say you have to, you know, you think of, you want to change the arrangement a little bit. Do you find that a lot of new bands are open to it, or are they kind of set in their ways? Like, no, what do you know?
I've only maybe had one or two over the past gazillion years, or let's just say in the last 10 years, I've only had one or two artists who kind of fought back, and it was only in both cases because of the love of the demos. You know what I mean? When you get too close to your demos, then maybe, you know, release the demo. And I'm not saying this sarcastically. I'm like, you know, release the fucking demos. If that you really love them that much and that's how you feel like the record should end up sounding like, well, you have the demos.
Yeah.
But that's happened a couple of times, but not really that bad. I mean, I feel like, a lot of these, younger artists or whatever artists that I'm working with, they kind of welcome it. And I also am very, I'm very specific in not being a my way or the highway guy.
Okay.
But I will give, you know, like my typical thing is I get a demo of a song and I'll just listen to it. I'll chart it out, like the structure. And then I'll just do a bunch of ideas, changes. And then I'll just email the artist with all the bullet points. And, you know, I'll say, you know, if there's something you don't agree with, that's fine. Let's talk about it. If it's something I think structurally really is a problem, I'm going to push for it. But I'm not, you know, it's your record.
Yeah.
But, you know, like singer-songwriters, when they send me demos, like every song just starts on the vocal, you know. And it's like, well, maybe you could have an intro because they don't have the patience, you know what I mean, to put an intro in because it's about them. They want to just start singing.
Right.
You know, that doesn't always make a great song. You know, the intro is to set something up or, you know, a guitar melody, a different section of an intro, you know, like just,
yeah.
So there's things like that. And, you know, my thing about the whole Steady, which, you know, they were so fantastic to work with. I love those two records.
Let your boyfriend deal with the dealers. It only gets inconvenient when you want to get high alone. You don't have to know how to get.
I kind of looked from the outside in and saw what their patterns were. And I kind of just helped shake up the patterns. And I remember just saying, like, little things, not, you know, not in any negative or douchey way, but like little things like, you know, well, you know, how about it's not a chorus unless you could sing a harmony on it? Think about that. Right. Like, that's what floor should be, like little things like that. And then we took that, and I remember I was very, how do I say it? I was very much about the bridges with them. Like certain songs, I wanted them to add like the third section or the fourth section just once to break it up and make it, you know what I mean? Like it needs something else. Okay. Let's add a bridge. And they didn't do that on every song, obviously, but I mean, where we did it or where they did it, it really, you know, to help develop. And with the new kids recently, it's been, or the younger kids or the artists I've been working with recently, it's been fantastic because they all love it so much. And I also make it fun. So it's not necessarily, you know what I mean? Just like me telling them what to do, but it's ideas and interesting ideas. And then we just have fun realizing it. So it's 2020, apart from, you know, obviously the pandemic, which shut everything down up until March, I was involved in four really fantastic records. And, and you know, we'll see when any of these come out.
Yeah, and when you bring a, you know, your sense of humor to it, it kind of helps. To me, it would help loosen me up.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've been in the other situations where I visited sessions that were super tense, and honestly, that sucks. I don't want to visit that. I don't want to be sitting there 12 hours a day like tense, like hating everybody in the room. You know, if I did that, I would spend more time with my family.
Now you're forced to.
I'm just kidding.
So I've got a question. It's kind of, I want to ask it in two different ways, I guess. Has there been a project that you've turned down that you've regretted turning down? And on the converse, have you been involved in a project that you regretted taking?
I have.
Perhaps I should have emailed these to you beforehand.
No, that's fine. I'm weighing the diplomatic way of dealing with this.
Right.
I got an interesting 90s story that I regret my decision, but I think I made it at the time on a really, on a solid basis. But, you know, at the point when I was working a lot with Don Fleming as his engineer, he had done previously Bandwagon-esque, the Teenage Fan Club record,
yes,
which quite honestly is one of my favorite records from the 90s. I mean, I still love that record. It's top five, maybe top 10 of all my favorite records. Okay. I mean, there are so many records, but that one really means a lot to me. It really does. I love them. I love their harmonies. I love their songs. But anyway, they were getting ready to do the next record, which I think ended up being 13, they called it. And then Don was producing it. And then obviously I was going to engineer, and I was over the moon. And then Michael Beinhorn called me, and he had a band called Hammerbox from Seattle that he wanted me to engineer. And I really liked Michael, and I'd worked with him a couple of times, some really cool records. I turned him down, and I won't say he got mad at me, but he was not expecting me to say no.
Yeah.
Which was not a great business move on my part. Sorry. This is part of, I'm going to interrupt for a second.
Yeah.
Having a 15-year-old daughter is somehow my computer is sitting in a pool of water all of a sudden.
Oh, no.
Which I don't really understand how that fucking happened. I think I'm okay. Anyway. So I turned him down. That did not go well. He was very upset. Yeah. I did not work with him again. And then Teenage Fan Club decided to do the record themselves.
Oh.
So I ended up losing both gigs. And that was kind of a bummer. So that one really hurt.
Yeah.
There's a couple, like there's the trend going on now in mixing, where the artist will, or the manager of the artist will, or the record company will basically send you an invitation to do a test mix for a record. Like, here's a song, we're having eight people mix it. we're going to pick the best one, and then he or she gets to do the entire record.
Oh, geez.
And the way I deem it is I'm not really into competitive mixing because I feel like everybody has their own style, and who's to say my style is better or worse than her style or his style? You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And I just don't like the idea of it. And I've tried a couple. I've gotten one. I've lost a few. But I decided that when that happens, when I'm mixing on those kind of scenarios, I'm not really mixing the way I mix. I'm mixing like, you know, I'm not mixing creatively. I'm mixing like trying to get the gig.
Right, right.
I'm not doing things I normally would do. So I decided to just say no to those requests. And there have been some artists that, you know, it would have been good to work with. But I don't like the idea. And honestly, it's so random. Like, you know, somebody's mix could just be louder. You know, somebody could do a mix and then master it and send it, and it just sounds better. I mean, so he gets the gig, or she gets the gig.
Yeah.
So there is that. There's a couple of artists that I've refused to do test mixes on. I think the National was one. I just, to me, this is not why I make records. You know what I mean? Yeah. I cherish, at this stage, I got to say, I cherish working with, like, I worked on this Roan Yellowthorn, this woman's record. She's 30. It's going to be her first, well, it's going to be her second full length, but this one's a little more realized. Okay. But, you know, we really did great work on that record. I mean, God, the arrangements, she sent me just piano and vocals, you know, doing the chord changes, and we made them into songs. And the arrangements are fantastic. Her voice is beautiful. Oh. She's another one with the chicken skin or the, you know, yep. Like she hit this one song called Unkind, which I love. And in the pre-chorus going into the chorus, she sings a melody of one line, which might be one of my favorite melodies like I've heard in a, like, it's just beautiful. Wow. The way she hoops up, and I every time I hear it, I'm like, ah, you know.
Oh, but, wow.
I'm not gonna waste my time chasing you. You'd only drag me around. I'm not gonna waste my time, waste my time, waste my time on you. I'm not
is, and now at the end of the day, 2 months later, we FaceTimed yesterday for her older kid's birthday, and my daughter Bella wore the unicorn mask, and we sang the kid happy birthday. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So when I'd rather be in those scenarios, you know, where I'm working with younger kids, but you're helping them do something fantastic, and then, you know, then they're going on, and, you know, I can only make the record, then you hand it over to the label and they have to really do their thing. But with records like with Hop Along or Waxahatchee, where you do the record and it does really well, and then they get propelled to do good stuff. You know what I mean? It's a great feeling. It's a great feeling to help people get to the next level.
Now, talking about mixing, I do have a question for you. And I know vinyl's making yet another comeback. Do you have to change the way you mix things based on the format it's going to be released in, whether it's vinyl or digital download, CD? Even cassette. I mean, does the final end usage of it influence how things get mixed?
No, because I think at this point I've been doing it through originally vinyl, then CD, then, you know, MP3, then listening through the phone, listening to the shit device. You know what I mean? I've gone through that all. And I, honestly, I feel like I know when it sounds good to me. And then Greg puts his magic on it. It's going to sound great everywhere.
Oh, cool.
And you know, I every now and then I'll pull out my phone just to hear something really quick as a reference. And I'll listen to a song on my phone. And, you know, it's like, gee, okay, snare vocal, cool. Because it's all the same. And those are the frequencies.
Yeah.
But the thing is, no, I don't anymore. And, you know, it's funny. I used to really... In the 90s, I was a car reference. I got to go listen at home. I got to send the first mix to Greg. He'll listen. He'll let me know what he thinks. And now it's like, it sounds good. Let's roll.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like I'm very comfortable. I will say what I do in the studio, my quirk that I still do, which drives every one of my either assistants or engineers crazy, is whenever I start a session, my monitor reference, just to get tuned into the monitors, is the Dino song Get Me.
From Where You Been. Yes.
The trembling words don't make my eyes close. Any woman you'd know, I can't find out, cause you won't show when it's all. Every dream is shot by day.
It's very open, and I could just sit there and listen to the speakers, and then I can tell what the frequency response of the room is, because I'm not even saying that song is perfect top to bottom frequency wise. It isn't, but I know what's wrong with it.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Okay.
So when I listen to the low end in the room on that song, I know it's like, okay, it's kind of, the room has a little more low end than I'm used to, because you know what I mean? Like, yeah. I just know the song so well.
Okay.
So I do that. That's the last kind of nutty thing I do.
Now, I saw you did recently produce an album for an Olympic snowboarder.
Oh, Pat. Yeah, that was fantastic.
I saw that video on YouTube. That's a neat little video.
Dude, he is. And, you know, it's so funny. And by the way, that was the last time I saw Lanegan face to face.
Oh, really?
Because he was playing in Lausanne while we were working. And then we went to the show. And then he dedicated No Easy Action to me.
Oh, nice.
Kids were like, what the fuck? And then we waited at the end and hung with him. And it was fantastic.
That's one of my favorite tracks, too. I love that song.
Oh, God, he's so great. I love him. Anyway, but so the kid, they reached out to me. The kid reached out. And I kind of didn't really focus on the snowboarding thing until I got there and realized, like, one night, the studio. So we tracked in his house, and I mixed back here in the States. But one morning I woke up, went down to the control room, and a bunch of like the Olympic official guys were taking his blood, like giving him the mandatory. I was like, what the fuck? He's like, yeah, I got to get a blood test every like 3 months.
Wow.
Yeah, so they surprise him. They just show up.
Oh, my gosh.
It's severe. But no, he's a super talented guy, wrote really cool songs. I think he was inspired by the Kurt Vile records and the Phosphorus record.
Those are amazing.
Yeah. So I think that was his zone, you know, he really wanted that kind of vibe, and it was fun. I really like, you know, I like working there. We had a great time. I mean, I lived in their house. The kids in the band were great. The parents were really nice. We had dinners with the parents every night. I felt like I was an exchange student. Like world's oldest and dumbest exchange student. Oh, my God.
So tell me a little bit about this podcast that you're doing, Gear Club. How did that get started?
So when me and my lovely wife, Sharon, got married in 2003, my best man was my brother, Tony, and my groomsmen were Stuart Lerman, who's old buddy of mine from the 80s. He's a producer, too. Fantastically talented guy. Great musician also. And Greg Calby, who's a mastering engineer that I've talked a lot about on this podcast. And they had not met, they hadn't really known each other that well at that point in 2003. Well, after that, we became the groomsmen. We started golfing. We'd have dinners. We'd hang out. We'd go see shows together. And one night, my brother Tony said, and this is about 3 or 4 years ago at a dinner, you know, my brother said, you and Stuart should do a podcast. And I was like, you know, we were like, what are you fucking talking about? We're so busy. We got, you know, like we don't have, he's like, you guys should do it. You guys are really funny together. You know, your banter's great. You really accomplished both a lot in your careers. You know a lot about making records and all this stuff. You should do a podcast. We're like, no way. And it was like, he kind of badgered us a little bit. And then, you know, a couple months later, he basically said, look, I'm send you guys into the studio. We're going to record just you guys talking about music. And we're going to see how it goes. I think it'll be fantastic. We're like, okay. So he basically set it up. We did it. He did some edits and he sent it back to us. And it was actually very cool. And through that, you know, we got my daughter Bella, who you met, who to do the intro.
Oh, awesome.
And the little blurb in the beginning is literally that first day when my wife Sharon called while we were recording, and I had this whole conversation with her, and she's totally making fun of me because, you know, the shit I do is boring. You know, she's like, I bet it's thrilling. And I'm like, yeah, it's fucking thrilling. In fact, my career is thrilling. It's really fucking thrilling. So anyway, so we started doing it. We've tweaked the format a bunch, but you know, we've had really fun ones. I mean, Kurt Vile was fantastic. He was so much fun. Adam from the War on Drugs was great. Patterson's was wonderful.
Yeah.
So we've had artists. We've had classic producers like Tony Visconti, Jack Douglas, great engineers like Kevin Killen. I'm going to leave out somebody and someone's going to get mad. But, you know, I had a segment I did solo at Camp Fuzz last year with Dino, where I just interviewed the three Dino guys.
Oh, wow.
That was a side one, but we decided to put it out as Gear Club anyway. We've had my buddy Josh is a photographer who took a lot of the iconic Beastie Boys and Clash pictures in the 70s. And
oh, yeah.
Just neighbor, good friend. And we had him on because we thought it would be fun, and he was great. And my buddy Bill Burrs is like the Hall of Fame radio promo guy from the 90s and zeros.
Oh, you know? Cool.
Slash and the Strokes and Foo Fighters and, you know, just a million bands. We had him on. It's a loose format, but honestly, it's just us fucking around. You're not fucking around. We're asking questions. I'm like, the dynamic is like Stuart's insightful and really, you know, ask really wonderful questions. I make fun of Stuart. I'm kind of a smart ass. And then every now and then the guest talks a little bit. it's very good.
Those are the best kinds, but it's very loose. Those are my favorites.
Apparently, and I don't remember some of these digs, but apparently a buddy of mine emailed me the other day and said, dude, just listen to the last podcast. Someone was talking about a high def room. And I guess I turned around and I said, yeah, that reminds me of Stuart. He puts the def in high def. Like, I have no recollection saying that, but that's the kind of shit I would just say. And they thought it was really funny. So whatever.
So how can people listen to the show? Where is it at?
I mean, I think it's everywhere. I think it's on iTunes. I think it's on, you can listen, you can stream it just through gearclub.com.
Okay.
Clubpodcast.com. It's pretty easy to find. I mean, Gear Club is basically Gear Club. If you Google it, you'll find it pretty good. But we also have an Instagram page, a Facebook page, and all that bullshit. Awesome. But honestly, it's a wonderful thing to do. In fact, my brother's got us doing Zooms once a week. We did one with my mentor Bill Whitman and the two guys from the Hooters, Robert Eric, and it's just fun to do. Today we're going to do one with Kevin Killen and Tony and Lenny from the Patti Smith Group.
Oh, cool.
So that's just because it's easier to do, you know, it's fun to do the Zooms, and I guess we'll record it for future. But what I was going to say is it's a wonderful thing to do, and honestly, it's just me and Stuart just get together. We do it in person. We invite the guests down and then we hang out for an hour or two. And honestly, once we're done with the interview, my brother Tony, and you know, he does all the editing and he kind of deals with all the stuff. So, you know, you were saying you're a one man show and you do everything. We're kind of lucky because like we just, you know, we wash our hands and we're done. It's like, never in my life have I ever felt like the talent. I kind of feel like I'm the talent. It's a nice feeling.
That's awesome. Well, okay. So before I wrap up, I really appreciate you spending so much time with me today.
No problem.
Who have you been working with that we need to keep an eye out for?
Okay. So the one that made it out in time before the pandemic is a band called Warriors. Okay. It's a woman, Lauren D'Anizio. She's from New Jersey. She lives in LA. 4-piece band. She's got a beautiful voice. She writes great songs. And it's like, I think it's a 10 song record where every song is just super cool. You know, she's just great. It's kind of, I don't know. I hate, you know, saying, oh, it's pop punk. It's this and that, because it's, I don't know, but it's guitar driven, but great melodies. She's got a beautiful voice and the lyrics are really great too. It's like, it's, you know, it's just a really, it's a wonderful record. That one you could Spotify. Just need answers. For Clap Your Hands, Say Yeah, at the middle to end of last year. And that's honestly, I just think it's because of the climate right now. It's not going to come out for a while. But that's fantastic. And he's so fucking talented. And I've been a fan of, that's Alec from the band. He's the main guy. But that record is something to look out for because it's really adventurous, beautiful arrangements, really interesting strings. And, you know, it's basically the as cool, but the opposite of the Warriors record, you know, okay. Warriors, because it's not, you know, it's not guitar, bass and drums. It's all kinds of different things, but the songs are wonderful too. He sings the shit out of that song. And this year, you know, basically, so I did a wonderful record with a female singer named Lauren Stevenson, who, congratulations, just had a baby in February. They got the baby out just before the pandemic.
Wow. That's,
I know, crazy. And that record is wonderful. She just has a beautiful voice and sings great. What's great about this record is some of the songs are in a key where I swear she reminds me of like classic Stevie Nicks.
Oh, wow.
Trying to sound like that at all. She's just singing, but it's beautiful.
Out from the tunnel you walk, all with rungs of gold surrounding you like golden laurels. You chalk your hands and you clap clouds and moon.
And there's a couple of acoustic songs. There's a couple of mid-tempo. There's like, you know, whatever. It's very organic, but yeah. Great. There's a couple of rockers, too, that are fantastic. Okay. So her record is fantastic. I told you about Roan Yellowthorn.
Yes.
I love this woman. Her name is Jackie McLean. She's unbelievable. I am so proud of the record we made together. And I went back and looked at my notes the other day, and it was like, I just can't believe we went from piano changes to reference vocal to just this beautiful record.
Wow.
I'll give you a couple of others. Oh, the Courtneys from Vancouver. Mm-hmm. Earth pop, very teenage fan club, inspired like arrangements, three piece female, really great. That was fantastic. And that's on a record, a label called Flying Nun. That one hasn't been mastered yet, so I'm not sure when that will be out. And then I mixed a record for a really awesome band called The Nude Party, some 20-plus-year-old dudes. And that's really fun. It feels like all those great records that we loved in, like, the 70s and stuff. Like, a little Stone Times, a little this, but really just, once again, not copping their shit, but just loose and fun, great melodies, really great performances, just a fun record.
Oh, that's awesome.
I tell you what, like in a year, a lot of people are going to be talking about these guys because they, and even I know people have seen them live and they're fantastic.
Oh, so, maybe we should get them on the podcast.
Yeah, no, they're real. There's like eight of them. So be careful. You might want to get them on a Zoom because it's a lot of them. And it was funny when they came for the mix in like early March, March 2nd, at one point it was like a Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock or 11. And it was me and Jeremy, the assistant. And then an hour later, it was like a fucking party. There was like 12 people.
Oh my gosh.
Like, yeah. The sound of the mix changed. There were so many people in the room. It was like, wait, where's all the low end? I think that's pretty much what I got.
Awesome.
But I feel like there's a lot of, a lot of good stuff. And like I said before, I'm really cherishing working with the kids because I feel like, you know, they're just so much fun. And I guess it's also because, you know, I have a 31-year-old daughter that I'm comfortable with the kids. And I know that you're right, like the joking around and, you know, not being too serious or pretentious. is fucking great. So
yeah, and I think that they appreciate that too, because I know a lot of guys will go into the studio a little apprehensive, especially if it's their first time. So I think helping them stay at ease.
Yeah, I mean, look, like I said, my thing is I'm there all the time. I've been going into that room for like 30 years. I am not going to be miserable in there. I'm going to have a good time.
Yeah, exactly.
Because, you know, I want to look forward to going to work.
Yeah, exactly. Well, John, thank you so much for spending so much time with me, man. It's been a blast. It's been some great stories. Thank you so much.
Oh, that was great. Listen, thank you. I mean, like I said, I listened to the Mark episode, and I was like, this shit's good. So I was really excited that you asked me to do it.
Oh, thank you. Go back and listen to all the other ones. I've had some really pretty cool guys, like Michael Girard came on. Alan Johannes. So had Al on, so he was one of my favorites. That was a long episode. He's one of the only guys that ever, when I asked to do the intro, he actually pulled out his cigar guitar and just actually strummed a little intro for me.
Oh my God, this is the end, my friend. If I do that, would that bring everybody too down? my intro's an outro.
Yeah, they...
This is the I'm dyslexic, so there is that.
That'll be perfect.
I went out in the storm, got a fit.